Last time, we divided economics into microeconomics, macroeconomics, and econometrics. This time, let's review the research methods in economics. Based on research methods, economics can be divided into theoretical economics and empirical economics. It's an obvious point, not just economics, but most academic fields can be divided into theory and empirical research. So today we'll delve a bit deeper into these topics. First, let's look at each one. Theoretical economics involves creating new theories based on existing laws, axioms, and definitions. Like all theories, it starts from previously established principles, axioms, definitions, or laws, and develops new theories through deductive reasoning, inductive reasoning, or proof by contradiction. Once these theories are established, they become new laws themselves. This process requires logical rigor, which is why mathematics is heavily used. In the past, economic theories were written in plain language. This is why many people think of economics as similar to philosophy or the humanities, something built on words. However, since the 20th century, economics has shifted toward using mathematics rather than words or text to maintain logical rigor. Mathematics is, after all, the most logical language humans have. Adam Smith, the father of economics, explained economic theories in words in The Wealth of Nations. But nowadays, theories are developed using mathematics. Reflecting this trend, we add the prefix neo to economic schools of thought. For example, what was once called the classical school of economics is now referred to as the neoclassical school after its theories were formalized mathematically. Similarly, the Schumpeterian school, which focuses more on technology than mainstream economics, is now called the neo-Schumpeterian school. The neo prefix indicates that the logic is developed primarily through mathematics rather than words. Interestingly, even in philosophy and the humanities, where logic is traditionally expressed through words, mathematics is increasingly being used. This trend was largely influenced by a brilliant thinker, Ludwig Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein was an exceptionally sharp mind who developed the picture theory of language. One of his famous ideas is, "Whereof one cannot speak, thereof one must be silent." He theorized how the philosophical world could be proven mathematically. The field he created is called mathematical philosophy. Before moving on, here's an interesting anecdote. Despite his groundbreaking work, Wittgenstein hadn't earned a doctorate. When Cambridge University wanted to hire him as a professor, he had to write a doctoral thesis. He had already published many research papers, but a doctoral thesis is different. It requires a formal defense. He wrote a very short thesis, Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus. I'm not sure about the exact pronunciation. When he defended it, the examiners admitted they couldn't understand it. They said, "We'll never understand this, even in our next lives, so let's just approve it and move on." Isn't that fascinating? Wittgenstein was a truly unique individual. He left Cambridge shortly after and even wrote papers while sitting in the middle of a war zone. His attitude was, "If I'm destined to die, it doesn't matter what I do." He was an extraordinary figure, and his work, Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, holds significant academic value across disciplines. However, I wouldn't recommend reading it. It's incredibly difficult. If you're looking for foundational works, I'd suggest Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus and Gödel's Incompleteness Theorems. But I wouldn't recommend reading the original texts. They're both extremely challenging. Now, back to economics. In summary, theoretical economics involves presenting new theories through logical deduction from existing theories or laws, and the method of presentation relies heavily on mathematical logic. Of course, there's also empirical economics. As mentioned earlier, empirical economics uses statistical methods to test the validity of economic theories or to see how well they align with reality. Last time, we discussed how economics can be divided into microeconomics, macroeconomics, and econometrics. Roughly speaking, microeconomics and macroeconomics fall under theoretical economics, while econometrics falls under empirical economics. But this is only a rough classification. In actual research, you'll find that theoretical and empirical economics are inseparable. Why? Because all theoretical disciplines have a fundamental limitation. What if the theory doesn't match reality? In theoretical work, we use hypothetical frameworks. Let's call them spaces rather than coordinate systems. In mathematics, this space is always Euclidean space. Since theories are validated within this Euclidean space, all theoretical disciplines have inherent limitations. This is essentially what Gödel's incompleteness theorem is about. In natural sciences like physics, Theories are often established through inductive reasoning, observing natural phenomena, and then formulating equations. This makes them highly likely to align with reality. But economics isn't like that. While economics also builds theories from observed phenomena, many theories are derived mathematically from axioms. And when discussing economics, it's often called the science of assumptions. Human behavior is too complex to capture in a single equation, so economic theories rely on assumptions. Without assumptions, it's impossible to model human behavior mathematically. In natural sciences, the laws of nature don't change much. Unless God recreates nature, once a law is established, it's unlikely to be wrong. But economics deals with humans. Human behavior can always change, which is why economics needs assumptions. For example, one of the most common assumptions in economics is that humans are rational. This assumption is essential in classical economics. Let's revisit microeconomics. What do we study in microeconomics? We explore what choices are optimal under given constraints. To make this clearer, let's use an example. Suppose someone earns $10,000 a month. They could spend it on food like rice, wheat, or noodles, or on things like car payments, mortgage installments, and so on. Microeconomics calculates which combination of choices is optimal. Here's the key point. If this person isn't rational, we can't find an answer. At the very least, their preferences must be consistent. If they prefer bananas to apples one day, strawberries the next, and watermelon the day after, we can't calculate anything. Rationality doesn't mean perfection. It just means their preferences are consistent. Without this consistency, optimization in microeconomics becomes meaningless. For example, if we calculate the optimal allocation of their $10,000 budget, and the next week they suddenly say they don't eat rice at all, we'd have to start over if rice was part of the optimal plan. This is why microeconomics assumes humans have consistent preferences. Behavioral economics challenges this assumption. The founder of behavioral economics, who holds a PhD in psychology, argued that such consistency doesn't exist in human behavior. This led to a re-evaluation of economics. However, even behavioral economics requires some assumptions. As mentioned earlier, it's impossible to model human behavior mathematically without any assumptions. Returning to the main point, economic theories require assumptions, and since human behavior can change, even the most mathematically rigorous theories have inherent limitations. This is why empirical economics is necessary. Nowadays, even if a paper presents a theoretically brilliant and mathematically flawless proof, it won't be accepted unless it aligns with real-world data. What does this mean? Even theoretical economists must produce basic empirical results and include them to have their work recognized. Empirical economics, in turn, cannot be separated from theoretical economics. After all, empirical economics is the statistical testing of economic theories. If it's separated from economic theory, it's no longer empirical economics. It's just statistics. This is why theoretical economists need a strong mathematical background. In fact, many physicists and mathematicians transition into economics. You've probably heard stories of physicists becoming Wall Street quants, using mathematics to make investments. Physics and economics are deeply connected through mathematics. Econometrics also requires strong mathematical skills, but in a different way. While theoretical economics relies on fields like analysis, algebra, geometry, and calculus, empirical economics leans more on statistics. Recently, computer science has become increasingly important because data is central to economics. With advancements in computer technology, big data is now widely used in economics. Machine learning is also being applied, leading to more realistic empirical economic models. Network theory is another popular approach, where technologies or economic indicators are modeled as nodes in a network to study their connections. Let's dive deeper. The reason empirical economics exists is that experiments are fundamentally impossible in economics. In fact, economists are often more mathematically adept in statistics than engineers. Why? Because engineers can conduct experiments, so they don't need deep statistical analysis. They have experimental results. They can control variables perfectly. By changing one variable at a time in a controlled environment, they can see its impact. Natural sciences also have some constraints, but they can conduct experiments. For example, to determine the gravitational constant or air resistance, we can experiment in a vacuum or with varying air densities. But in economics, social experiments are difficult. Think about it. How would you conduct a social experiment in economics? The most famous example is Marxism. Based on Marx's ideas, socialism and communism were implemented. While the theory sounds plausible, we can't know if it's correct. Historically, communism has proven difficult to implement, but at the time, no one knew how it would turn out. If this were natural science or engineering, we could have experimented. But in economics, experiments are impossible. How would you test Marx's theory? You'd have to divide people into Group A, capitalism, and Group B, communism, by force. To conduct a precise experiment, you'd need to divide people into multiple groups and assign them independently. That's impossible. Marx's theory was historically tested, but not by design. While we can't say it's been perfectly validated, comparing capitalist and communist systems today gives us some idea of its validity. But there are countless economic theories, not just Marxism. We can't test them all, nor should we hope to. This is a limitation not just of economics, but of all social sciences. That's why statistical methods are so valuable. Experiments require controlling all variables except the one being tested, which is impossible in economics. But if similar events have already happened, they provide valuable data. For example, the 1994 study by Angrist and Kruger on minimum wage is a classic case. They compared minimum wage changes in New Jersey and Pennsylvania to analyze their impact on employment. New Jersey raised its minimum wage, while Pennsylvania did not. This was a natural experiment. Card and Kruger's 1992 study also used similar data. They analyzed the relationship between education levels and income by comparing regions where educational opportunities expanded with those that didn't. Angrist's study on the Vietnam War draft lottery is another example. He compared the long-term income and health outcomes of those drafted versus those who weren't. The challenge with such studies is ensuring the groups are comparable. For instance, if volunteers for war are more patriotic or physically fit, comparing them to non-volunteers would be biased. Angrist's study used the draft lottery, which randomly assigned people to the draft, eliminating bias. However, the sample size must be large enough, typically over 3,000 people, to be statistically meaningful. There are other methods like Heckman's two-stage model or propensity score matching, PSM, but we won't delve into those here. Let's move on to Richard Thaler's nudge theory, which falls under behavioral economics. Unlike classical economics, which assumes rational humans, behavioral economics does not. Nudge theory refers to small changes that lead to significant effects. For example, placing healthier foods at the front of school cafeterias increased their consumption. Classical economics can't explain this, as it assumes preferences are fixed, but simply changing the order altered behavior. This is the essence of nudge theory. Another trend is big data and machine learning. As mentioned earlier, these are widely used in predicting consumer behavior. For instance, if you want to know what your friend likes, just look at their computer. Google uses search history and browsing data to show personalized ads. Scary, right? Companies like Amazon and Netflix use algorithms to recommend products or movies based on user behavior. Traditional economics would analyze this data empirically, but with big data and machine learning, real-time personalized recommendations are possible. This applies not just to consumer behavior, but also to financial markets and labor markets. To summarize, economics is divided into theoretical and empirical economics, and the two are inseparable. Recent trends include behavioral economics, which complements traditional theories, and improvements in statistical methods in empirical economics. The influence of computer science has also led to the use of big data and machine learning. Next time, we'll classify economic schools of thought. See you then. Don't forget to subscribe, like, and turn on notifications. Leave a comment below.
The first rule of channel is subscribe channel. Second rule of channel is click like. This channel will make you smart.